And a lot of good things have happened, and we got a lot to share with you and to bless you with today. And we're just so glad just to be back home this morning.
Amen.
Amen. How many miss us? All right. Well, we certainly have missed being here. You know, prayer is my life, the word is my life, church is my life, and just fellowshipping with the saints is my life. And when I miss that, amen, it seems like the main source of my life is cut off. Amen. So I just thank God for the fellowship this morning. As I walked in the door, the praise team was just ministering so beautifully. Amen. They just really ministered this morning, and I was trying to get Sister Dorothy to sing me that special song before the musician left, but you don't have to have musician. All she has to have is the Dorothy. We just really appreciate the worship team. They've been doing a marvelous job. Amen. And we thank God for our new sister, Brianna. Amen. She has come back, returned, joined in, and she's doing a marvelous job. Sister Denise and Sister Sharon. Amen. We just thank God for them. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. This morning, we really appreciate the ministers that have been standing in for us, ministering and sharing. I've been hearing about how God has been using them and ministering through them. Brother Donnell, hallelujah. Let's give him a good God bless. Amen. I'm pretty sure he feels how it is trying to cover so many bases on Sunday morning. Amen. And all during the week. So I'm just delighted to know that we have somebody that can stand up to the plate and really minister, carry on when we are not in your presence this morning. Amen. Before we go further, Brother Wayne, I don't see him this morning. Okay, but we just thank God for Brother Wayne. I understand he's been faithful in ministering, and he's been a blessing as well. And we just thank God for all of the saints. Amen. God bless you this morning. Before we go further, we're going to ask Sister Hill to come and share. A lot have taken place since y'all saw us last. Amen. So Sister Hill is just going to come and just share briefly, however the Lord leads her. Sometimes brief is not brief, but as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. How many know that Sister Hill is a minister? Amen. All right. Amen. So God bless you, Sister Hill. It's a blessing to have you to share this morning. And we will come back and share a little later after Sister Hill finishes.
Good morning, Northside. It's so good to be back home. I tell you, when Pastor and I were coming of Cincinnati, up or down, whatever, I said, you know, it's been 1 month since we have traveled this way. And as we got near to the church, my heart just began to rejoice that I was coming into the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'll tell you, it's been a blessing. I thank you, Northside, so much for being there for us. And before I get into my remarks, which are very brief, I want to just again acknowledge Brother Williams and Brother Wayne for just really sitting in and doing a marvelous job. I mean, an incredible job. Let me just say, on Saturday evening, when I had just brought Pastor from the hospital, I called Brother Williams, short notice. And I said, Brother Williams, he didn't even know he had been there, because I wanted to tell people that the pastor was in. He didn't want anybody to know. And I said, at least you can tell Brother Williams, the assistant pastor. So finally it came to a point where he had to do that, because he knew he he wouldn't be able to be here that Sunday morning. So he said, call him. And I want you to know, Northside, that when I called Brother Williams, he didn't change words. He didn't say, why did you wait till the last minute? Why didn't you call me before now? You know, why? He just said, I think you're going to have to sit in. I thought a couple of weeks, that's what I told him, for a while. And he said, okay, we can do that. I want you to know, that's the kind of assistant pastor that we have. He said, we can do that. So I want to say, give thanks to him for all this short notice. And not only just that, being here on Wednesday night and all that, Brother Williams got a little bit more of a taste of what pastors should be. A little bit more, but we really appreciate you.
Amen.
Likewise, Brother Wayne and his absence, we appreciate him so very much.
Amen.
I've heard some really, really good things about the messages, and would just like to thank you so much. And also the faithful prayer warriors. I wrote this down so I didn't want to forget anything. The faithful prayer warriors. Brother Travis, where are you? I saw him earlier. There's Brother Travis. But just being so faithful, and all of those that come to be a part of the intercessory ministry. Let me tell you, we felt the effects of your prayers. I tell you, sometimes we wondered if we're going to get through it. But I knew Northside was praying, so thank you so very much. And to all the ministers of helps, the ushers, I see Brother Rod back there, and Brother Al, and those that, and all of you that, and I hear Brother Curtis talking about the sign, and I'm excited about that, and all of those that have helped to make this minister what it is. And I couldn't forget Brother and Sister Smith, who come out early. You know, the Bible said early in the morning. You know, there's a scripture in Psalm that says, oh God, my God, early will I seek thee. Hallelujah. And that's been one of the scriptures that stayed with me every day that I wasn't here. I would go over that scripture, that passage of scriptures in Psalm. And so we want to say kudos and thanks to the Smiths for being so faithful. And also, while we're giving thanks, we don't want to forget anyone. So I want to say thanks to all of you. But sometimes we forget our own.
That's right.
I want to say thanks to, anybody got some tissue here? Thanks to Derek.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And to you, they have been just like the rock of Gibraltar for us.
Amen.
Derek would come over, I think he missed one night, every night, to see about us, to see about his dad,
Amen.
To make sure everything was going well. We couldn't ask for a more caring son and his family. So we say thanks to him. Thanks to Eric. And I want to say thanks to Brother Williams again in the Vacation Planning Committee. That's what I call you. For wanting to send us on a trip to Hawaii. Because it was that Saturday. Thank you, Brother Rod. Thank you so much. It was that Saturday when we had the Founders Day dinner that we sat at the table with the Williams. I don't know if they noticed it or not. I think Brother Williams did, because the idea was born in him to send us on vacation. And one of the things in retrospect that I noticed was that Pastor was very quiet. Did you notice that?
Yes.
Hardly said a word.
Amen.
And hardly ate. And I thought, something is not quite right here. And little did I know that was the beginning of what was to follow. Maybe not the beginning, but very quiet. And we went through, and I'll get into that a little bit later on, some perilous times. And I just thank God that we're here this morning. Now, he's not a very detailed person when it comes to things like this. But I'm not going to tell everything. but I'm going to tell more than what he'd tell you, because I think you need to know. I'm going to tell you more. And I can't forget this beautiful praise team. It's so good to see Brianna. She's been back for a month, I believe, and we haven't seen her face, but we've heard her. And our thanks to the commitment that you have, Sister Dorothy, Sister Sharon, Sister Brianna, Sister Denise, and I was to see, we want to welcome Brother Joseph as a part of the praise team. Is this your first day? Second? Oh, amen. So glad to see you. Now, just in case I forgot someone. Welcome back, Eva. We miss you so very much. Amen. Trust that you had a good summer. Amen. Well, praise God. I told Pastor 10 minutes, and I've got my 5 left. Well, I want to talk to you briefly about what it's like making it through a storm.
Amen.
Making it through a storm.
Amen.
I don't know if you've ever been in a storm, but I have. I mean, outside. You know, it's okay when we're in a shelter and we hear the winds blowing and the noises outside. We feel kind of okay if we're in our homes or in a safe place. But sometimes you're not in your home. I remember driving all alone, because Pastor had a commitment here at Northside, to my oldest brother's funeral. Just me, all by myself, about 8-hour drive. And about halfway there, I went through a storm. And it was a turbulent storm. I mean, extremely turbulent. I was driving, and it seems like suddenly I drove into, and the clouds were dark, looked like they were hanging just right above the trees. And I began to pray, and I says, you know, and I thought about Yolanda's song, Yolanda Adams, while riding through the storm, God keeps me safely in his arms. And I began to pray, and I began to pray, and says, Lord God, you know I'm all alone in this car. But I'm not alone. You're with me.
Yes.
Take me through the storm. The winds were blowing. The trees were laughing. And I was driving. And I says, and the rain began to fall. And it was just awful. I said, should I pull off? Or should I keep going? What should I do? I am inquired of the Lord. And you know, sometimes that's what we have to do, stop and inquire of the Lord. And it seems as though he said, just keep going.
Amen.
That is what I did. And suddenly, not after a while, but suddenly I drove out of the storm.
Amen.
And on the side, other side,
yeah.
Do you hear me? On the other side,
yeah.
It was clear, bright, and it was like, so black. And then, but I just kept driving, and all of a sudden there was a brightness in the sun. And the Lord just let me know that when you go through a storm in your life, that's what I'll do for you. That's exactly what I'll do. So I want to talk about making it through the storm. It was a Wednesday. Pastor got up and he said, you know, I'm going, this is not a normal prayer, it was about 9:00 in the morning, I'm going to our church to pray, and I feel like I just need to go and pray. And I said, oh, okay. He said, I'll be back in a couple of hours. Okay. He did just that. He came to church, nobody here but him, and he prayed and came back. I sat on the sofa, and when I went to the room, I said, how was it? He said, good. And I know he didn't look right. And I said, are you okay? he said, yeah, I'm okay. So I went on upstairs and began to do some things that I normally do. But the Spirit just said, go back and check on him. So I went back downstairs, and he was still sitting in the same spot. I'm going to tell it because I know he won't tell it. But he was still sitting in the same spot. And I said, honey, are you okay? Because he had this strange look on his face. And he finally said, no, I'm not okay. And I said, what's wrong? He said, my head is hurting. Where? These are the questions I asked. Right in the top. And I could look at him and tell that there was an emergency. I needed to do something. And I said, do you want me to take you to the emergency room? He said, yes. Well, I had on my work clothes, and I said, you know, some crop pants or whatever. I said, well, let me go get redressed. He said, no, come on, take me now. So I said, okay, we got in the car, and went, and I'm going to try to abbreviate this. And I had called his doctor earlier. They told me he could get in and out quicker if I took him to the surgery center. That's what I did. And they took his pressure, boom, way, way up. Now this was after prayer. I'm talking about making it through the storm, y'all. You hear me? Hear me. He prayed a couple of hours, but that pressure was way up. And I thought that, okay, they'll get it down, they'll do something, we'll be home, be out of here in a little bit. Not so. They kept taking it. And yes, they gave him medication to bring it down. It didn't come down. And, well, you have to wait a little while later. Gave him more medication. It still didn't come down. And I said, well, can we just go home? And the nurse said, no, that would be like malpractice if we send him home. And I said, well, what are you going to do? Well, he needs to go to emergency to the trauma center across the street. And it was like, oh, Lord God, no. That's my thinking. And so I said, okay, I'll take him. They said, no, you can't take him. Why? I brought him. Why can't I take him? No, it's too dangerous. We need to transport him, Elsa. You just meet us over there. And that's what I did. And we were in the emergency room. Let's see. I left home about 10. It was about 3 o'clock before he got a bed. And needless to say, he was exhausted, and I would too. I hope you all were praying for Sister Hill as well. Yeah, it's been a challenge. Without going into too many more of the details, he was there from Wednesday until Saturday. Lots of tests, lots of this, lots of that, and all that. And I want to tell you, this is the first time Pastor has ever really been sick. Never been in the hospital before. Never. So this was like a foreign experience for him. And it was a challenge for me. Because there were times when I think Pastor thought, this may be it. This may be it. And I began to pray, and I began to tell him, you got to put your life before the Lord. What have you done? All the prayers that have gone up, they've gone up as a memorial before the Lord. All the people that you help, it's not your time yet. God still has a work for you to do, and he is not through with you yet. And in the midst of all of that, he's just talking just above a whisper. Just above a whisper. And I know that things were looking pretty dark, but I was there to encourage him. You can make it. You can do this. You can get through this. We can get through that. We're in the storm now, but we can pass over on the other side. And how many of you know that sometimes when you're in a situation like this, you just feel that, well, if Jesus was in the next room where I could touch him physically, things would be okay. But you, hallelujah, but you can't touch him physically. But you just got to know. You got to know that you know that he's with you. And will never leave you and nor forsake you. And the scriptures, let me just say this, the scriptures that I know, that I memorized many years ago, they began to come before me. We've got to make sure our anchor holds and grip a solid rock. Because it was during that time that I felt like, well, the scripture is there, but I'm not feeling it. Have you ever been there? Ever been there? I'm not feeling it. And then the scripture, Psalms 46, began to pop into my spirit. That God is a refuge and a strength, a very present help in trouble. It didn't say he's a future help. He said he's a very present help in the time of trouble. And because he is, we're not going to fear what comes upon us. That scripture goes on to say, though the mountains be cast and carried away in the midst of the sea, and I envision that as an earthquake or some kind of force of nature, when these things come against us, they are forces. But yet we are able to stand. And then the scripture, I jotted these down, Psalms 50, 14 and 15 came before me to begin to offer, not bask in what was going on, but began to offer thanksgiving unto the Lord. And I read that and it says, and pay thy vows to the Most High. And I says, Lord, you know we have been faithful tithers. You know we've been givers. You know we've been faithful. So I am offering thanksgiving to you now. But then the next scripture, the 15th verse said, call upon me in the day of trouble. He didn't say, I'll turn my back on thee, or I'll wait and see. He said, and I will deliver thee. And then thou shalt glorify me. Glory to God. Says, cast thy burdens upon the Lord. It was indeed a burden. If you've never been there, you don't know. Cast thy burdens upon the Lord. And what he said, he will sustain thee. He will sustain thee. And all these scriptures began to roll over in my spirit. And I said, Lord, we can't go down. We're going up. We can't go up. Hallelujah. Scripture says, and he shall never, suffer the righteous to be removed. He shall never, it didn't say sometimes, but he said he shall never suffer the righteous to be removed. So I began to stand upon the word. And I just want to challenge you today and leave this with you, Northside. You have been taught in the Word. You've read the Word. You've studied the Word. You know the Word. And you bask in the Word. But when you are going through a storm, the Word, you are challenged. And you've got to be able to stand on what you know. You've got to be able to magnify Him in spite of what's going on. You've got to be able to give thanks and lift your hands when the situation looks dark, when it looks dim. You've got to be able to say, I will trust in the Word that I know. I will magnify Him. I will continue to praise Him. I will. Lord, I'm in the storm now. Lord, I know you have, you carry me in your arms. pastor. It was a little challenge. Y'all know sometimes, you may not know, but sometimes he can be stubborn. You know, I love him, but sometimes, some of you that really know him know, sometimes he can be stubborn. You have to say, you must do this. You gotta do this. No, you can't do that. And sometimes I just, in the 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, when I finally got a bit of sleep, he wake me up. Seemed like I can't get my breath. It was like, I just want to sleep though. You know, I need a little sleep, just a little rest. But I was there for him. I was there for him. What do you want? And I'm here to tell y'all, I have done more cooking in this last month than I have in a long time. Praise God. Pastor, would you come at this time? Several members that sent money by and cards, and we want to thank you for everything, all of you, everything. We really, really appreciate everything. Thank God that I say Pastor is 3/4 of the way back. Amen. Sister, not quite there yet, but 3/4 of the way back. Amen.
She looks good.
Praise God. Amen.
All right, praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, the Bible says we call the things that be not
as though they are.
As though they are.
Yeah.
Amen. So I'm back.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. His promises as men count blackness. Hallelujah. We just thank God for his faithfulness today. All right, so Sister Hill shared the natural side. The human side, and there is a human side. And then there's a spiritual side as well. How we can say amen. And we just really appreciate the words from Sister Hill. And I think that she always shoots from the hip. And always, amen, praise God, expresses what she feels down in her heart. But I just want to say that she's been very faithful and committed to helping me, serving me, and getting me back on the right track. He couldn't ask for a better, amen, a better spouse, a better wife, amen, and a better support, amen. I just want to say that we do believe that God has already answered our prayer. We just do believe that the word of God never returns void of power. Amen. It has always been my belief that the word of God is reliable. How many can say amen?
Amen.
God's word is reliable. God said that he stands behind his what? Word to perform. And we're going to have challenges. How many can say amen? And everything that we are believing God for is not going to take place always, you know, instantaneous. So we're going to have to stay on the word of God. But one thing that we do know about the word of God, scripture says that his word will not return void. I had an opportunity to speak to my brother this morning. He called me. He just returned from Haiti. And he was there three weeks. And he's 10 years older than I am. And he said that you experiencing some of the same things that I have experienced in my ministry. He said that there were times that I had to stop and I had to rest for 3 months without even preaching. Amen. Sometimes we do go beyond our limit. Sometimes we don't rest as we should. And sometimes these things can, over a period of months and years, it can really add up and really take a toll on you. Amen. Sometimes the anointing is flowing. Gary said, I'm adrenal. Amen. I supply that energy, that motivation, that strength, and that anointing. Sometimes we feel that we are supermen. But I just thank God for standing behind us and really giving us the grace to go through. Amen. Because I do believe that God, amen, has under this word, scripture, we always say, many times you hear me say it in prayer, that God said his covenant, he will never break it. Amen. Neither alter the word that has come out of his mouth. So God is faithful to his word, and I know that whatever promises he has made, whatever word that he has given us, whatever promises that he has made in his word, God is faithful. And the scripture says that we have to hold fast to our confession of faith without wavering, because God is what? Faithful, that promise. Amen. How many believe that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever? Amen. How many believe that he will never leave us, neither will he forsake us? How many believe that he will always stand behind his word to perform it? How many believe that his word is forever settled in heaven? How many believe that God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent?
Feel to us.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We have to walk by what? The word of God.
Yes.
Oh, but just shall what? Live by faith.
Yes.
How many can say amen?
Yes.
But just shall live by faith. Hallelujah. Glory. But that third verse says what? But the what? But the law. Well, let's do the second verse. Oh, for the what?
Law
of the Spirit of Christ. Oh, has made me what?
Free.
How many know that we are free? Hey, ha! We are free from the what? Law of what? Sin and death. Now realize, hey, he the Son set free shall be what?
Free.
How many can lift your hand and say, I'm free from the law of sin and death? Oh, if the Son set you free. The Bible says he has delivered us out of the power of what? Darkness. And he has what? Translated us. Oh, God had to quicken that word to be all over again. Yes, he has delivered us. Oh, how many can say, I'm delivered, I'm delivered, I'm delivered, I'm delivered, I'm delivered, I'm delivered out of the kingdom of darkness, and I'm translated into the kingdom of it. What the law could do, God did what?
Yes.
He sent his only Son.
Yes.
In the likeness of what? Sinful flesh.
Yes.
And did what? Condemn sin in the flesh.
Yes.
Hey. So that the righteousness of the law might be what? Fulfilling us who walk not after the what? Flesh, but after the Spirit. That was the word, amen, that God took into me. We have to walk by the Spirit, amen, and praise God. That's the thing that brought us all the way through. Amen, praise God. Even all the tests that we took while we were in the hospital, everything came out that I took. Amen. Praise God. That was nothing negative. Just amen. Hardly nothing negative. And it was almost a perfect report, almost. Hey. How many know that God be for you? How many can say God be for you? How many can say God be for you? Who can be against you? Greater is he that is in us. Showed up. And let the ministers carry on. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He said, people be glad just to see you.
Amen.
I would like to see this morning. Hey! Hey! Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I know that God, amen, brought us through.
Yeah.
And God has given us victory. Amen. And everything. Amen. Praise God. God is causing all grace to abound to us. So we will have sufficient. Amen. Praise God. This time we're going to turn it back into the hands of Brother Williams. Might have other remarks or a prayer. Let me just thank God for all of you here today. Amen. Brother, let me kind of get on my mind. I just want you to just calm down. You just want to just calm down. I just want to lay hands on you. So happy for Brother Eno this morning. All right, Pastor.
Thank you, Lord. Glory to God.
I want everybody just to stand and just point to this couple. We're praying that God will continue to strengthen the hill. He's been very busy and. Amen. Praise God. But we're going to pray that God will work everything out.
Yes, he will.
Amen. Every challenge, every crisis,
yes.
Everything that he places his hands to, we believe that God is going to intervene. Amen. Praise God. Everybody just point here. Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, you put this cup on my heart. Hallelujah. Lord, strengthen them with might and dear man. Give them the desires of their heart. Meet every need. Raise them up spiritually. Break every yoke. Loose every band. Oh God, we come against the work of the enemy. In every manner, in every strategy that he tries to come against the good. Father, in Jesus' name, you sent your word.
Yes.
Hey, you sent your word. You sent your word, Lord. And work, and I do what the devil has tried to do. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, for his completeness and his deliverance, his breakthrough. Even financially, in Jesus' name, undo the hand of the enemy. Release your power, your anointing, to lead and to direct his life. Give him beautiful ashes. In Jesus' name, give him grace. Lava Boko Rabakata Shata. Lava Boko Rabashata. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, for her release. Inside and out. Glory, her release. From the crown of her head to the sole of her feet. In Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord. Follow up for making them complete in you. For they are complete in you. We give you praise and we give you the glory now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. God, take well this morning. Pray for your condition. Lord, you're the same yesterday, today, forever. Mm-hmm. send your word, hey, to work. Oh, God, in Jesus' name, bind every hindrance. Come against it in the name of Jesus. Lord, give them strength. Oh, God, be with them, Lord, in every procedure, whatever method, whatever way that you have to assist him in his complete healing and deliverance. In Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you, oh, God, that your word will not return void. We thank you, Lord, that you are faithful to that promise, and we'll hold fast to our confession of faith without wavering, because we know that you are faithful to that promise. In Jesus' name, be healed, be delivered, be free, be completely whole from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Hey, Kandalaba, Koshandalaba. Lord, give them strength, lift them up. Glory, help them to expect, oh God, perfectness and soundness throughout his body from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. In Jesus' name we pray. We give you the praise of the glory. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
Come on, let's worship the Lord. Hallelujah. If I can get there, I just want to share this a little bit with you. Verse 15. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and external weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are. You're going to have some, you're going to have some war stories. You're going to say, I remember when I was broke, how many here I ever been there? I remember when I was broke. I didn't have money, didn't know where it was going to come from, but somehow the Lord brought me through. Praise God. Challenge with sickness, challenge with whatever you may be challenged with. Don't get stuck there. Look down the road. And the only way you're going to look down the road is the Bible says that you got to be like that man who looks in the mirror and behold himself to see what kind of man he is. That's the way the book of James. And then when you turn around, you got to keep that image in your mind. You got to keep that image. I'm a child of God. I said, don't turn around and forget what the word said about you. Once you look in it, keep that image. Keep that picture before you, praise God. So here, and Paul says again in the book of Romans, that's kind of a parallel to that same scripture, Romans 8 chapter, verse 18. Pastor Hill was awful close to that this morning. Romans 8, 18. For I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For I reckon that the suffering of this present time is not this. You're going through something like it won't even be worth talking about another month from now. So that was something that was easy. I didn't know. Wow, look how God brought me. It just won't even be in your memory after all. It's not worthy of what God, the benefit that God's going to show through you, he's going to show how he's working on your behalf. It won't even compare. The contrast to be so different. Amen. Praise God. And we have to understand that what was God's original purpose for me? So I live every day trying to act like I'm the first Adam before he failed, before the fall. But the best way now is to say, okay, I have another example, the second Adam. Amen. But I have to understand the plan for both Adams were the same.
Amen.
Praise God. So God's original purpose for creating the visible world was to establish an invisible kingdom.
Yeah.
Remember the prayer Jesus says, pray like this, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we have heaven, the invisible, we have earth, the visible. The objective is to bring them both together, and God wants to manifest himself on earth through man. So if you're looking at the temporal self, it has nothing to do with the reality that's in the spiritual realm, heaven. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. Well, we'll have to understand that in heaven, things are spiritual. The Bible says God is a what? It's a spirit. So here I'm physical in a visible realm, but I must communicate with an invisible God. And if I will allow the physical to dictate to me, then I'm going to lose out. I must look into the invisible and see what's in the invisible and bring it into the spirit, the physical, so I can know the things that are freely given to me of God.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. It's kind of tough. Kind of tough to get to wrap the mind around that. But God is a spirit, and they that worship him must communicate with him in house. Spirit. Not by the dictates of what I can see. Things that I see physically are base compared to what I cannot see with my natural eye. But if I can look into the invisible, if I can look into see what's in heaven, understand what's in the invisible God's mind, and put it in my mindset, then I can overcome anything that is earthly. That's heavy, but you get it at about 3 o'clock in the morning like I did. Think about that. God is a spirit. And he operates on the invisible plane. And if you allow the physical to dictate to you, to be mastery over you, you're going to lose out. Hallelujah. See if I can just find a few more scriptures before time runs out. So God wants to manifest the spiritual in the physical world. Here, he created man in his own image. Spirit, body, soul. With the capacity to operate in both realms. The realm of the spirit and the realm of the physical. And just because we're in the physical, we got to have a good time in the physical. Hallelujah. Don't neglect that. Yeah, you're supposed to enjoy yourself in the physical, but it's not to be the superior force. It's the spiritual, the invisible. The things that you can't see, it's the rule maker. Sets the game plan. So right now your game plan, I don't know anybody's game plan, you may have run into trouble. And you say, then what do I do? This stuff is here, it's for real. Now what do I do? You can't look at physical stuff, the circumstance or the evidence. The Bible says, he that observed the lion vanity will forsake his own deliverance. So if you keep looking at the depleted bank account, the messed up body or whatever, if you keep looking at that, you're going to forsake your own deliverance. You have to turn around and immediately look into the invisible. Thy kingdom come, your will on what? Earth as it is in heaven.
Yes.
For me.
Hallelujah.
See, I'm going to be biased. For me. I love Sister Yvonne, but hey. For me. For me. That will be done in on earth as it is in heaven. I got to get this. And what it means is that you got to get understanding. You got to get revelation knowledge. You got to get into fellowship with the invisible. Now some folks take the wrong track and do it through witchcraft and all kinds of other means, praise God. But you have to do it through your spirit being connected with God, born again, connected with God's spirit. That's how you have to do it. And if you can just close out everything else, even though it seems so real. How many know broke is real?
Amen.
You reach in your pocket, there's nothing there, that's real. But you keep reaching it and depending on that pocket, it becomes more and more real.
That's right.
But if you stop looking there and say, hey, there's a system that's called sowing and reaping.
That's right.
I got to figure out how to get in there.
That's right.
There's a system called prayer, communicating, fellowshiping with God. I got to figure out how to get in there. Because every time I go to what's manifested here on the earth, I'm coming up empty. But I understand things in the invisible never change. And what's there? How many know that there's no sickness, no poverty, no disease in heaven?
That's right.
None of that in the invisible world. And you can bring that in those invisible realities into your physical world if you know how to work and deal with God. That's the simple way I can say it, praise God. Okay, we're creating the spiritual beings. How do we do it? We receive revelation, understanding from the invisible realm, since God is a spirit. Our purpose on the earth was to dominate our world, dominate our existence. So he placed us in a visible, physical world, and he said to his created one, dominate it. See, he took us, the invisible, said to his visible man in a physical world that God created, dominate it. And you can argue all you want to, but every time I go to Genesis, it says that God said to man, dominate it. Everything that I created, have rule, control, and dominate.
Yes.
And what man lost out, as we know through all of our teachings, is that sin got in the way and things turned upside down. Hallelujah. So, glory to God. Ooh, I'm just kind of rushing. Someone to say, take your time, will you?
Take your time.
Thank you. Okay. Because of the fall of Adam and Eve, we get their curse. It's a reality. We have to deal with that curse because of Adam and Eve. And what happened? An outcast, one that was outcast from heaven, He occupies a place that they vacated, and we are conditioned to live in fear, hopelessness, and despair because we see the curse that they receive and has been passed down through all the generations. So therefore, without knowledge of the invisible realm, we put up with what Adam and Eve has left us. You don't believe in the spirit the first time, right after Adam sinned, he got so scared he couldn't talk with God anymore. He ran in here. Adam, where are you? Where are you? What are you doing? I'm hiding. I don't know how to communicate. I don't know how to work. I'm scared. I don't know how to work with you. I'm scared. God still loved Adam, but Adam is scared. And that's the thing about it. That's passed on to us. We are so afraid and frightened that we depend more on the physical. If I can't see it, I can't believe it. If I can't hold it, I can't believe it. Believing is the just shall walk by what? Faith and not sight. So it has to, we got to reverse. We got to get a mindset change, an existence set change. Instead of walking by the physical, I got to walk by faith that's in my heart according to the Word of God. We was over there in Romans, Corinthians, Paul says, I therefore believe, and now this is how I speak. Hallelujah. You can't speak by what you see. You got to speak by what you believe. Hallelujah. And it'll change your world. If you don't be careful, you stay in this whirlwind of despair, hopelessness, and fear. And the only way to get out of it is to start looking into the invisible worlds and working as in God's kingdom. What was His original plan for me? Even though I'm living, I'm experiencing, I see, I'm challenged with misery and all of the downsides, what was God's plan for me? What is His plan for me? And the only way you're going to get that is by, the Bible says here, revelation. Revelation knowledge. I'll just show you quick here in the scripture, if I can find it, I believe it was in the book of 1 Corinthians. I got stuff all over the place up here. 1 Corinthians, the second chapter, verse 7. I'm going to honor the title. I'm not going to keep you long. Is this worth hearing what I'm saying?
Okay.
1 Corinthians, the second chapter, verse 7. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. Even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, or for our benefit. Which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that do what? That love Him. And for those that God loves, He has prepared something from the foundation of the world for you. But your eye, your sense man, your intelligence, your common sense, they taught you in kindergarten from K to 12, it ain't in there. It's not in that newspaper. Your relatives probably won't tell you. Your best friend don't know this. Well, what the Bible is saying is that, but God has revealed them unto us by how? His Spirit. The invisible is telling you. The Spirit searches all things, yet He knows all things. So to spin out of what you're in, the whirlwind, just like Job was in trouble, and he thought he had it made, and he got worthless advice from the wife and friends. They're all telling him from a sense knowledge, common sense, man, you know something is bad. You did something wrong. We're your best friends. You can depend on our counsel. But the God told them, they're counseling you without knowledge, without revelation knowledge. They don't know. They don't know my intent for you. The Bible says it's an intent to bring you to a good end, to give you to a good life. St. John 10:10 says, life with abundance. abundant living. Hallelujah. But if you keep talking to someone who's broke, sick, and ugly, but God has revealed them unto us by His Spirit. Verse 12. Now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things how they're given to us freely. Just like Adam was in Eden, the Eden blessings. He was there. He never had to work. Just lay down and go to sleep, lay up next to Eve, have it made. How do you like that? I said that Wednesday. Brother, you had with there with Eve next to Eve all day, and you decide you're hungry. You just walk over to the potato patch. Get something to eat. Want something else? Walk over there and get it. Eve. But now that you sin. Now that sin has been found in your life, guess how you have to receive it?
Sweat of your brow.
So it's the blessing versus the curse. And now the second Adam has brought us back to where the first Adam was before he failed. But you won't find that reality, that news, that information in the newspaper or the Tom Jones show from K through 12. You're going to have to get a prayer life, a Bible study life, a good church, a good pastor, a good teacher. Praise God. You're going to have to get that revelation knowledge in you. Because when the contrary stuff of life comes up, you'll know how to overcome it. You won't be stuck looking at that. You'll see the bigger picture. This is just a light affliction for the moment. Watch me overcome it. Watch me work with God and overcome this. Because I know, fairly convinced, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So it was all about bringing heaven down to man and joining those two together. Man's rule and his reign is going to be on the earth. Man, made from dust. When we leave out of here, guess what we go back to? Dust. Man, given one place to rule. Earth. The heavens, all of them belong to God. There's only one thing He's given to man. The earth. And you ought to get frustrated like I did. And if earth is beating me up, I'm going to say, this is lopsided. I'm the dominate. I am to rule. And the more revelation, the more word knowledge I get, the more you see that you are in the rulership. You are doing the dominating. But the things of the world, the physical world and so forth, will try and tell you that, no, it has to be this way. No, God never intended for you to be under. Never intended for us to suffer and do without Him and be, you know, just under. He wants us over and more than over. I come that you might have a life and have it in abundance. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I come that you might have a life and have it more abundance. And you've got to buy that verse. Hallelujah. The kingdom of heaven, what is it like? It's like a man when he found something in a valuable ground. He found it there. He hid it in that ground. And then he went and he said he sold everything he had so he could have that ground. That's what the kingdom of heaven is like. You got to sell out everything so you can get into and understand and operate in that kingdom knowledge, revelation, understanding. So whatever it is that's blocking you from getting that kingdom knowledge revelation and experiencing it on the earth, there's just something in the way, that's all. It could be sin, it could be a lack of knowledge, it could be you just have to find it. What is it? Because he says the man went and sold all that he had. The woman at the well says, give me what you got. Jesus says, if you knew what I had, you will ask for it. And she says, give it to me. Whatever it is that you have, give it to me. She will give it to me. that life, that blessed life that you had given. This is what your neighbors come to find out when they see you overcoming, when they see you walking in the blessing, that your neighbors, your friends, your relatives are going to come ask you, how is this? How is this? How did you overcome? Because God wants it to be revealed through man on earth what it's like in heaven. Ooh. I thought the music would strike up. It did this morning. All right, so we're about to finish up. And here it says, look at Psalms 115 and 16 and we'll be out of here. Boy, I should have stayed on the Corinthians. I'll just say it. It's understandable, we've heard it before. Since by man came death, by man also come life. That's the second Adam. So even so, in Christ, you'll all be made alive. I Adam lost the kingdom of heaven on earth. Jesus has come to restore the kingdom. Adam did not lose heaven, but he lost the control of the earth. Adam never had control of heaven. Adam had control of the earth. And the second Adam is to come to give us, Adam's kids, control back. Ooh. Thought y'all want to hear them know now. Okay. Psalms 115 and 16. Somebody get it. What does it say there? Psalms 115, 16. Glory. The heaven, even the heavens, are the Lord's. But the earth had he given to who?
Children.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Glory to God.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Yes.
You got to get that revelation knowledge. You got to put that against anything that you face that come your way.
Amen.
I'm in control. The bank say ain't got no money. Guess what? I'm in control. I dominate. You can go pray. You just might go find a penny. And you might find a piece, a loaf of bread, a sandwich, and plant it in somebody's life. And that's enough to trigger the even blessing for you on the earth. One woman had, Jesus said she had a penny. Everybody else throwing in big money. She came in with all she had. So I'm like, wouldn't say that. Jesus says, this one right here, everybody else throwing in big money. But look at this one right here, she threw in out of her need. She's going to be blessed above all women. So you got to know how to operate in the sword and the reaping. It's different than the Babylonian, the buying, the selling. Praise God. Boy, if I stay up there longer, I have a charge. Glory to God. Someone say praise the Lord. Was that a blessing to you? Here, receive it. Take it home. Study it. Hallelujah. See if what I say is true or not. Praise God. God wants you to dominate your world. Praise God. Every day, every hour, every minute. He wants you to be in charge. And he'll work with you and show you how through revelation knowledge. Understand. Well, let's pray. Hallelujah. I'm sure we did pray for everybody that had a need, had concerns. Hallelujah. We want us to touch and agree. First of all, is Jesus your Lord, your Savior?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Is this Lordship, His Word, the rule? He says, why do you call me Lord and you don't do those things I say? Praise God. That's what He wants to know. Is He Lord? Is He ruling? Is His Word ruling? It's like the final arbitrator of whatever you got to deal with in life. Is His Word that final arbitrator? Let's stand. Let's have prayer. Glory to God. You are the strength of our life. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, that we have testimonies to say. We have words to express. By those words we overcome. Hallelujah. By the blood of the Lamb. Word of our testimony. We thank you, Father, for restoring and healing our pastor. Even the first family, his whole household. The whole household of faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, the shepherd of this flock. We thank you, Father. As we go forward, hallelujah, with great expectations. We're not fixed on the current difficulties or the current challenges, but we see the bigger picture. We can do all things through Christ, which strengthens us. We give you all the praise and glory. If there be any that has not salvation, born again, experienced, if you can dare believe that in your heart and dare say it with your mouth, you shall be saved. We thank you, Father, for salvation. We thank you for deliverance on this earth and victory, victory on this earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah.